Solar geoengineering is the idea that you could, in principle, reduce the rate of climate change or reverse it by making the Earth more reflective, by reflecting away more sunlight, for example, by putting reflective particles, aerosol pollution, if you like, in the upper atmosphere, or by putting sea salt spray into certain kinds of marine clouds and making them whiter. There's a whole other set of things called geoengineering related to taking carbon out of the atmosphere. It bears essentially no relationship to the first one on grounds of public policy or science, so I will leave it separate. They're both ways we could potentially manage the climate problem. This idea is not new. The first serious report that arrived on President Johnson's desk about climate change included this as one of the things, in fact, the only serious thing that was suggested as a way to deal with climate change, so the idea is surely not new. There was essentially a taboo about talking about it, a taboo driven by the fear that talking about it would encourage people to give up on cutting emissions. That taboo was broken in 2006 with Paul Crutzen's article, and since then, things have really moved at a literally exponential pace. If you actually look at the citation rates, number of public talks, and so on, it's been quite literally exponential. At this point, we have sudden flowering of a bunch of research programs in Europe, a bunch of million euro class research programs on solar geoengineering. Nothing in the US, I think partly because of issues around risk communication and fear of uncertainty, partly arising from a press briefing or interview that John Holdren gave soon after he was named a science advisor where this topic came up. It is extremely polarizing. There are something like 1 or 2% of our fellow citizens who believe that this is connected with a plot to spray our fellow citizens with toxins from the air. This, is, of course, bears no relationship to the truth, but that is widely believed enough that I myself have had death threats we've had to deal with by calling the police. To give you a really specific proposal, to give you a sense of what we might actually do, there's a whole host of things, but I think it's useful to try, instead of talking generally, to be really specific. So climate change is driven by the steady buildup of greenhouse gases, most importantly carbon dioxide in the air, and that in turn means an increase in what we call the anthropogenic radiative forcing of climate, the thing that drives climate change. And there's other factors that alter radiative forcing, including sulfate aerosol pollution in the lower atmosphere, which kills roughly a million people around the world and also offsets about a third of the radiative forcing which is driving global warming. So let's say you wanted to offset half of the rate of growth of radiative forcing, which roughly would cut the rate of climate change in half. So let's say you wanted to do that with this technology. If you wanted to start in 2020, you'd start, of course, with zero because you're going to ramp it up slowly. And a decade after you'd started, you'd need something like 8 Gulfstream aircraft to take half of the climate change out, cost of about $400, $500 million a year. And at the end of that decade, you'd be putting about a sixth of a million tons of sulfur into the upper atmosphere, into the stratosphere. And if you did that each successive decades for, say, half a century, dividing the rate of climate change by half, roughly, the cost at the end of that time would be something like a couple $1 billion. You'd be looking at more like 40 or 50 aircraft. And you'd be putting in something still just under 1 million tons a year of sulfur. And I use that number. There's two useful ways to bound that number. One is to compare it to a natural experiment. Of course, we have a huge number of models, and I'm involved in a bunch of that science and modeling, but there are reasons to be empirically distrustful of these things. One really anchor we have was Pinatubo, a big volcano in 1991. Put 8 million tons of sulfur into the stratosphere in 1 year, and that had a lot of impacts, including actually slightly accelerating global crop, global biosphere productivity, creating ozone loss, a whole series of impacts cooling the planet down. But the point is, even after 50 years of cutting the rate of climate change in half, we'd still be at less than 1/8 of the Pinatubo impact. So that gives you a sense, a kind of empirical sense that while this idea is truly radical and scary in lots of ways, justifiably so, and also offers great promise in some ways, the scale at which we're talking about perturbing the system is in many ways something that we have experience with in the natural world. So let me say a few things about what the technology is and then move on to risk communication challenges. I would say there are probably three principal attributes of any of these solar radiation technologies, and that is that it is fast, that it is cheap, and that it is inherently imperfect. And all of those matter in different ways. The fact that it's fast means we can at least partially get around the enormous inertia of the climate problem. the fact that right now we need to cut emissions in order to protect our grandkids from climate change, but we'll see little benefit from that ourselves because of the slow buildup of carbon in the atmosphere. The fact that it's cheap is a double-edged sword. On the one hand, it allows the potential of really fantastic cost benefit. It's quite plausible, indeed the one serious crop model that's been run suggests that you could increase global crop productivity by reducing climate change through these methods by amounts that are quite measurable, 10, 20% class numbers, at this cost that's utterly tiny, so a 0.001% GDP kind of cost. On the other hand, the fact that it's cheap means there's at least potential for unilateral action, a potential for a kind of facile choice to just assume that this is the right thing to do and discount the long-term need to cut emissions. And that long-term need persists because it isn't perfect, because this cannot completely compensate for the risks of climate change. A world that you cool by putting sulfates or other particles in the upper atmosphere is not the same as a world that you cool, doesn't have the same climate as a world that you cool by cutting carbon dioxide emissions. An overriding factor, of course, of any of these technologies is that no technology alone will enable environmental protection or social protection from the risks of climate change without the will to use it and to make good decisions about it. So now some comments about public communication. Just in the last couple days, the first major public experiment on this topic was canceled. It was a UK experiment called SPICE and a mess of poor planning, conflict of interest, and polarized public debates. In my view, a central challenge in the near term is to find a way to do two things at once. On the one hand, have a healthy, broad-based, truly deep debate about how to think about these technologies that in some deep way alter the way we think about nature, because it makes the whole world an engineered artifact in some respects. And I think we need a deep debate about those that might well conclude we don't want to do it, or might conclude we want to do it quickly. And separately from that, I think we need to learn more. So I and others are proposing experiments, tiny experiments that in many ways, I think objectively, you can say really have no risk. In that sense, they're different from experiments in, say, avian flu or nanotechnology, where at least in principle, there's the possibility that a tiny experiment could create a risk because there's a possibility of self-propagation. But if you're talking about putting sulfur in the atmosphere in kind of 100 kilogram quantities, which is what we talk about for experiments, there's no direct risk because, of course, this is a much smaller climate perturbation than we make by, say, having a big scientific meeting. Of course, there are people who oppose the idea of such experiments, and I can see that in some ways that is legitimate, but what I think we need to do is separate the larger debate about what this technology means, how we make decisions about it, how we govern it, how we deal with issues of equity and justice, because not everybody's affected in the same way, while at the same time enabling some experiments to go forward so we can learn more about it. And I think experiments will teach us two things. They'll teach us some facts, and that's useful. They'll hopefully reduce our uncertainty about the risks and efficacy of these technologies. That's their explicit purpose. But also, experiments will teach us messy reality. It's very easy to have strongly polarized opinion about things that exist only in theory, to be really sure that they're awful or to be really sure that they're perfect. I think that experimentation will show us a middle ground, show us how messy this is, how imperfect it is, in a way that will actually make it easier to have a nuanced and serious public debate. Thank you.